Ever wonder what chaos ensues when two best friends throw caution to the wind?
And a dart at the map.
So I did a little recon on where the dart hit, and it is Buckland, Missouri.
Join me, Michael Mackie.
And me, Lonita Cook.
As we navigate the unknown in a new episode of Get Lost.
Buckle up, folks. It's gonna be a wild ride. Let's find ourselves by getting lost.
Right here on Kansas City PBS. Now, traveling has long been in my blood. I traveled relentlessly with my parents growing up. Now, they have both passed on, but they remain my central inspiration for having a deep, deep connection to the open road.
The same is true for me too, except my parents only traveled for bowling tournaments.
Bowling tournaments.
We never flew. We pile in the Buick and just drive across the country straight to the hotel. They'd bowl and then we'd hop back in the wagon and head straight home. I like to just travel for leisure or for pleasure, but to be honest, I haven't even explored our hometown the way I should.
Okay, well, girl, I got you because since the dart hit the map in Buckland, Missouri. Wait, what do you know about Buckland? Because I got nothing.
I got even less than that. But I'm always up for new discoveries.
Okay, well, perfect, because it's time to broaden those horizons and, well, should we let the map guide us or just use our dazzling sense of direction?
Map schmap?
Map schmap.
I want to follow my heart.
Of course you do. All right, well, like I said, I got you. Are you ready to get lost?
Girl.
Girl.
So I did a little recon on where the dart hit, and it is Buckland, Missouri, which is in Linn County, which is way northeast, kind of like God's country. So, but fun fact, the town that's before Buckland is, wait for it, Marceline.
What? Marceline.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
the childhood home of one Mr. Walt Disney.
Yeah.
Now, if you search the interwebs.
Search the what?
The interwebs.
The interwebs.
It will tell you that Kansas City is the childhood home.
Okay.
But then Marceline also claims.
Okay, now I've heard, and correct me if I'm wrong, but isn't there some weird connection to Walt Disney and the West Bottoms, or is it the East Bottoms?
Well, let me take a look. See?
Okay, you take a look on the interwebs.
Hot diggity dog. You are right. The electric park where we're headed now is a little bit before Disney's time.
Yes.
But the second electric park is the big bad boogie that inspired Disneyland.
Oh, two electric parks. That sounds like a Prince song.
Two childhood homes, two electric parks.
Two electric parks.
Yeah, this sounds like it get a little confusing, but I think I know just the person who I could put a call into who has shaken the shadows off this mystery.
I put in a call to Butch Rigby, founder of the Thank You Walt Disney Foundation. He's going to meet me for lunch, and we'll get the 411 on Mr. Walt Disney.
Oh, the man, the myth, the legend. Okay, well, while you do that, I'm going to take a twirl around Electric Park, because you know what? It's electric.
Woogie, 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 woogie.
It's like that Cyndi Lauper movie from the 80s vibe.
Oh, I love that movie so much. I used to watch that like every single day. I love Cyndi Lauper, but that Jeff Goldblum, he is one hot fish puppy.
Wait, a hush puppy is a vegan? Because if it ain't vegan, you can't eat it.
Oh.
In 1899, Kansas City was still formally segregated, a condition of our history that makes it difficult to gaze on the past with complete joy. But thinking on Electric Park gets us close. Existing for 7 years in the East Bottoms before needing to expand, it was a wondrous trolley park with flat-bottom boat rides, loop-de-loops, and, per its namesake, 100,000 electric lights. And the best part? Beer. Electric Park became so popular that they had to move, creating Electric Park 2.0. The second Electric Park was a massive upgrade from super to supercalifragilisticexpialidocious. With its vaudeville girls, penny parlors, Nickelodeons, and even more flat-bottom boats, it's no wonder it became the source inspiration for Disney's legendary theme parks.
Okay, Butch. As a Walt Disney historian and preservationist, maybe you can clear up this mad confusion. Did Walt Disney grow up in Kansas City or in Marceline, Missouri?
Well, he actually was born in Chicago, Illinois, and he was there till he was about 4 years old and does not really talk much about Chicago at all. He moved to Marceline 5 years old through about 9 years old, and he has many great recollections, or had many great recollections, of Marceline. I think those 4 years are like 40 years for all of us growing up, but he had that idyllic boyhood in a small town in Missouri and with the farm. And I think he learned a love for animals and some of the characters they drew over the years. He loved Main Street USA, but then he came to Kansas City at age 9, and he sort of learned about the realities of city life and maybe getting up at 5 in the morning to deliver the Kansas City Star with his father.
A feast.
Yeah, bring that popcorn over here for the movie guy, you know? Yeah, have a piece.
Oh, thank you so much.
That's good.
What's the magic of the amusement park that Disney drew on to design its entire legacy?
Well, when Walt Disney was growing up here and starting as a 9-year-old boy, he would go to the Electric Park. Now, he'd go to the second version of the Electric Park. Electric Park, of course, was developed and owned by the Himes brothers as a way to sell beer, the very place we sit this day. And they built their second, bigger, better park at 47th and the Paseo. And Walt was often quoted as saying that he loved going there as a boy, and he wanted to do something just like that, but he wanted his to be even better. And he didn't want carnival barkers, and he didn't want dirty boardwalks, and he didn't want some of the things. He wanted the perfect version of his memory. And so not only did he build a wholesome, family-friendly, and very clean park, but he built one that reminded him of his boyhood in Marceline, Missouri, with Main Street USA. If you look upstairs, you'll see his father's name, Elias Disney, on a window. And if you look in another part of the park, you'll see Laugh-O-Gram Studio from Kansas City in a window. And he did something that no one had ever done. He transformed what we had as a memory of the park, and he made it match his childhood vision and memory. And believe me, everything from your childhood is remembered much better than it ever was. Really, without history, we don't have much of a city. And I think that Kansas City is retelling a story, and people like the Riggers and Ryan Mabee and, you know, people all over this town always remember that history tells a beautiful story for the next century.
Hey, I got you a small token of my esteem.
Oh, yeah.
Look what I got you. When it matches what you're wearing. Oh, look.
I love it so much.
It says whiskey business.
That's right. It speaks to me. Then I got you something.
Ooh, girl,
super cool, too.
Oh, what'd you get?
Lunch.
Oh, thank you, baby. Jesus, mama need to eat. Oh, okay. Here we go.
Ooh. All right.
Okay, let's go. Well, you know what's on the way, my friend, is Excelsior Springs and the Elms Spa.
So you know what I need?
What do you need?
Do you know what I need?
I know. What do you need? Spa day!
I am so excited for the Healing Waters facial.
Man, what the hell is that? Well, I mean, I guess you had me at healing, also waters, also facial.
And the Elms hot stone massage.
Ooh, and really, who can live without a quartz sound ritual?
And a long soak in the hot tub.
Ooh, and then after that, we can go on the Elms ghost tour.
Ghost Ooh. Tour?
Yes, they're famous for their ghost tour. Girl, did you not know that this place is haunted? Well, allegedly.
Yeah, my muscles are begging to stay stiff.
Oh!
Have a great time. Oh. Deuces.
Okay, bye, honeys. Mm. Hi.
Hi, how you doing?
Hi, USBJ.
I am.
It's nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
What are we doing today?
We're gonna go find some ghosts.
Okay, so fourth floor is the creepiest floor?
This floor has the most activity around the hotel, yes, especially this end.
What's the worst room?
That's this room right here, 425.
Ooh,
okay, so 425, you've been hyping this room since I got here. What is the deal with this particular room?
425 is the busiest room in the hotel as far as I'm concerned. I've gotten more stories off of this room than any other. People telling me they felt somebody sit on the end of the bed, they look up, nobody's there, shadows in the room, the alarm clock won't shut off till you unplug it. I've been called for the AC and the heat more times than I can count. I get up here, it's working fine. About 12 years ago, I ran into four women checking out at the front desk at 11:30 in the evening, which is highly unusual. I walked up to them, I was like, is everything okay? Is there anything I can do for you? They told me the story of how they were sitting in the living room, door handle started moving. We were a busy hotel that night, there were people everywhere, and so they yelled out, wrong room. Door handle stopped and then started moving again. Again, they yelled out, wrong room, went and looked out the peephole, nobody there, opened up the door, looked up and down the hall, nobody there. So they got freaked out, so that's enough of that, which is where I ran into them checking out. I had to be the one to tell them, door handles are actually independent. You move the outside handle, the inside handle doesn't move. I had to tell them the ghost was trying to get out.
And with that, I think it's time for me to get out.
Back in one piece, I see.
I ain't afraid of no ghosts.
Nah, Chicky, you been acting black.
Dude, that sounds dirty.
You drive.
Okay, let's go. I'm ready to go. Come on. I used to travel extensively with my parents. We would travel all the time. I would travel all the time with my folks, and we would always get into like the nooks and crannies of everything. I mean, we would, if there was someplace off the beaten path, we would go. Like, if, you know, go to see like the world's largest ball of twine, or I'm telling you, there were times when I would spend hours just throwing rocks into the creek beds in Colorado. That little kerplunk sound would bring me an infinite amount of joy.
I got you. Hey, take this exit.
Where are we going?
I am taking you to see the world's largest spool of thread. And guess where?
Where?
Hamilton, Missouri.
Shut up.
Alexander Hamilton.
Oh, hands on the wheel.
Hands on the wheel.
Okay, where do you want to go first?
Let's call our friend Mayor Keith Gilbert and see what he has to say.
Well, okay, call him. Let's call him.
Hello, this is Keith.
Hey, Mayor Gilbert. It's Lonita and Michael.
Hey, friend.
You guys in town?
Not only are we in town, but we're going to need a tour guide. Are you game?
Showing my friends around Hamilton is my favorite sport.
We'll be there in two shakes.
Just a sec.
After getting the mayor's advice, we decided our first stop needed to be the J.C.Penney Museum. And what better way to get there than actually riding in J.C.Penney's 1947 Cadillac convertible, a gift from J.C. to his wife, Carolyn.
Welcome to the J.C.Penney Museum.
Thank you for having us.
Hi, friend. How are you? Thanks for having us. Michael, nice to meet you too.
Well, welcome. The museum is almost 50 years old.
Wow.
Okay.
And mainly built because this was Mr. Penney's boyhood home. That was actually his very first store, was in Wyoming. He said he would never open a store in Hamilton until the people that he learned the business from in Hamilton closed and went out of business.
Okay, so world's largest spool of thread next.
Largest spool of thread it is.
Okay, which one? That way?
Mayor Gilbert, this has been too cool for spool.
Oh, I see what you did there. Yes. Hey, Mr. Mayor, thank you so much. We appreciate you showing us around town and being so hospitable. Thank you so much. We're going to go learn how to quilt, so.
My pleasure, and it's quilting time.
It is quilting time. Quilt playing games with my heart.
I am quilty as charged. What? Ow.
After a quick look through at the Quilt Museum, it was time for us to do a little quilting of our own. We just need to learn how first.
Okay, Miss Thane.
Okay, we are ready. We are ready.
So you'll lay one on top of the other.
Mm-hmm.
Just like
that. Okay, just like that. Okay.
You're just going to sew that little seam.
Okay, here we go.
So there's your piece.
Oh, yay! All right.
Founded in 1854 along the Hannibal and St. Joseph Railroad, this entire nook and cranny city was, yes, named for the Alexander Hamilton, as well as the military leader who succumbed to the War of 1812, Joseph Hamilton. But Hamilton's only claim to fame isn't naming it after the Treasury Secretary-turned-musical theater icon, but also for its famed tourist trap, Missouri Star Quilt Company. It feels like the whole town has been draped in fabric. If you are a quilter, you will certainly find your people here. Checking into the historic Shoal Creek Bed and Breakfast in Hamilton, and folks, this place is dripping with charm. Built back in 1904, this stately home boasts all the trimmings of yesteryear. Think grand oak staircases, intricate woodwork, and those dreamy stained glass windows. I don't know if you're going to get me to leave this place, but it's movie night, and guess what's topping our must-watch list? That's right, Vibes, starring the legendary duo Jeff Goldblum and Cyndi Lauper. And after a night of laughter and nostalgia, it's time to recharge for day two.
Good morning, good morning. Be-do. I got you coffee.
Thank you so much.
We're gonna ease on down the road.
Don't you care,
nothing that might be a load. Come on, ease on down the road. Oh, who doesn't love a little MJ?
I'm talking MJ with M2.
Oh, yeah, you are. Well, you know what? Michael Jackson was, back in the 80s, he was a force to be reckoned with. I mean, he was omnipresent, and I'm not just talking about Thriller, because I think, did he not have a ride at Epcot, or am I making that up?
You are thinking of Captain EO.
Captain EO.
The George Lucas-directed, Angelica Houston starring space odyssey that Michael Jackson did for Disney.
Disney? Oh, you know where we going.
Marceline.
Wow.
Oh, this is amazing.
It looks just like Main Street USA.
But lived in. Like the fantasy is real.
As I live and breathe, Princess Mayor Sally.
Good morning and welcome to Marceline, Missouri.
Good to be here, my friend. And you? Okay, now, is there a parade every day? I feel like there's a parade every day.
Not every day, but we have been pretty frequent.
What is it like living in Walt Disney's imagination?
It's wonderful. Marceline is a great little town. Everybody is so happy, so helpful. We just really enjoy being here. It's a very safe community, and we just really, really enjoy Marceline.
Well, Disney is one of the world's most adored Imagineers. Tell us about preserving his part, or your part of Disney's legacy.
We have, as you know, a tremendous museum, a Disney museum.
Do you think we can go to the museum?
Oh my goodness, that's on the agenda today, yeah.
Come on, let's go.
All right.
Come on.
We trust that Marceline Main Street is the inspiration for the Main Street design in the Disney parks, but let's take a closer look and hear their side of the story.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to the Walt Disney Hometown Museum. Would you like a tour?
I would love a tour.
Ooh, and Mayor, I have some questions for you. So let's go.
Okay, so this right here is what we call the Marceline Project.
Okay.
So, 1956, Walt Disney comes back to Marceline, and he becomes friends with Russ Johnson. Him and Russ Johnson became business partners here on a project called the Marceline Project.
Okay.
So what this is Walt Disney said there's going to become a time of day where a child isn't going to know what an acre of land is, or they're not going to know what happens when you put a seed in the ground. So what Walt wanted to do was he wanted to take the actual farm that he grew up on as a kid, those 40 acres, and turn it into a living history farm. And unfortunately, Walt passed away before this project was completed.
Oh,
This was actually a personal sketch that Walt did. What he kind of thought the idea would look like. But this was such an important thing for Walt that this sketch right here, which was actually done by Walt, was on his desk the day that he died.
Oh, my, my.
So Marceline was always with him all the way.
Please tell me somebody found this sketch and it said, we're going to make it happen.
Well, I'll tell you this. The original 40 acres that the Disney family lived on, it's not a living history farm. However, those 40 acres have been preserved, and people are able to come to that 365 days a year from sunup until sundown.
Can you take us to this farm?
You'll absolutely
go. Can we see the farm? Okay.
All right, if you were a betting woman, how many visitors do you get annually to Marceline?
I would say definitely in the thousands that come specifically, well, not specifically for the museum, but they certainly tour while they're here. They come in by the busloads. And so I know it's up toward 10,000 probably a year.
Do you get international visitors?
Absolutely.
Where's the furthest place that someone's been from?
I know some folks that have been here from Japan.
Japan? Who are Disney fanatics?
Absolutely.
What, when you come in here, what are some of the highlights that we need to hit?
We're standing right in front of, actually, this is the desk that Walt used at the school, which is also named Walt Disney Elementary. You will see his initials here, WD.
Mm-hmm.
And so this for years sat in the school in a glass case and it comes to the museum. I think it kind of travels back and forth.
So this here is actually a really cool story. So this is a television set. It's from 1955, but more specifically, in 1955 is when Disneyland opened. Walt Disney invited his sister Ruth and her family to the opening of Disneyland. Ruth did not like crowds though, so she declined the invitation and Walt said, well, it's okay. You can watch it on TV at home. And this TV was actually a gift from Walt to his sister so that she could watch the opening of Disney.
Oh my God, he loved her so much. He said, I'ma accommodate you and I got something even better.
So we show the opening of Disneyland on a loop here as a tribute to what this gift meant.
Oh, hey.
You guys, I have never been so dazzled
in all my life.
Oh. He's taking me to the Disney family farm. You want to come with?
Sure. Is there food? Because I'm starving.
Oh, my goodness. How about some homemade chili? It was Walt's favorite.
Oh, let's go. We're there. Come on. Come on.
Though the farm is no longer in the Disney family, the spirit of Disney remains in it. This is where the young toddler moved with his family and, according to Walt himself, found the magic of his life.
So how do you all know that chili was his favorite?
Yeah.
So Walt actually used to carry around cans of chili with him wherever he would go.
He would carry cans of chili with him.
And so actually it got to the point where he would be going to these fancy restaurants and he didn't want anything to eat at the restaurant, but he would pull out his own can of chili and ask the chefs if they could heat it up for him.
Yeah, well, here's let's raise a spoon to Walt. Cheers to Walt. Princess Mayor Sally, back in the day, what was your favorite, like, Disney era?
It would have been several years ago when I was a young child watching the Mickey Mouse Club on probably a black and white TV.
So my era was, I guess, after the Disney heyday, more into the Disney animated feature presentations, Beauty and the Beast.
Oh yeah, the Disney Renaissance.
Yeah, okay, so all right, so I'm not the only one, definitely.
Thank you.
Oh my gosh, this has been so magical.
Thank you. I am going to remember you forever. Oh my God, this entire trip just touched my soul. Thank you so much.
You are so very welcome.
I loved every part, but Marceline.
Oh, Marceline. Oh yeah.
Arrow gave us a gift.
Yeah, Arrow gave us a gift. What do you think it is?
You want to open it?
Let's open it. Are you ready? Oh, look.
This is so cool.
Look what little Arrow got.
My little
Arrow strikes again. See what I did there? Oh, hey, we doing it again next week? I'm guessing we're going to do it again next week.
You bet your bottom dollar.
Oh.